sure you've heard about Apache Kafka, but have you heard of its modern alternative, Red Panda? Red Panda was released in 2021 as a Kafka-compatible streaming platform, and it has some impressive benchmarks. But does it live up to the hype? Let's find out. We're going to compare both Apache Kafka and Red Panda for things like architecture, performance, and deployment. And by the end of this video, hopefully, you should have a good understanding of what event streaming platform you should use in your next project. Event streaming platform. If that's the first time you're hearing that term, then stop watching this video and watch this one by us that introduces Kafka. The link for it should be in the description. So, if you've watched that video, you'll know that Kafka was built by LinkedIn in 2011. Wow, that's almost 15 years ago. But despite its age, it's still used by lots of tech companies like Netflix, Uber, and of course LinkedIn. So it must be really good at event streaming, right? Then why would anyone use Red Panda? Well, let's first compare their architecture. Both Kafka and Red Panda have a concept of producers and consumers. Events are sent to consumers via topics, which are managed by brokers. But Kafka is based on Java, and up until recently relied on Zookeeper to manage broker metadata. Red Panda is built in C++ and uses a single binary without any dependencies. It also has a thread per core model, which means each application is pinned to a CPU core to avoid context switching and blocking, which is really cool. So because of that, Red Panda wins it for architecture. Let's move on to deployment. I'm a huge fan of containerization, so I tried deploying them both with Docker. If we compare both Docker Compose files, we can see that Kafka has slightly more configuration options. And I really tried to strip out as much as I could, but Kafka's configuration is just more complex. Yes, newer versions of Kafka don't require Zookeeper anymore, but it still has dependencies like JVM. Red Panda comes with everything built in: schema registry, HTTP proxy, automatic partitioning, and much more. It's also Kafka compatible, which means clients like this Kafka Python library will just work with Red Panda without making any changes. You also get this admin REST API, which gives you things like broker and cluster information. And if you want to visualize this on a nice web-based UI, you can use the Red Panda console. So this means deployment goes to Red Panda. But when it comes to performance, then things get a bit interesting. In an ideal world, I would have run these benchmarks myself using the Open Messaging Benchmark Framework. But I had so many issues when it came to installing these benchmark tools for Kafka. And even though Red Panda was a lot easier, I didn't have access to the super powerful EC2 instances that you needed to run the benchmarks. So we'll have to rely on blog posts and articles. And boy, are there some varying results when it comes to comparing these two. This Red Panda blog post claims that when testing their performance against Kafka with a 1 GB throughput on 3 different EC2 instance types, Red Panda running on 3 nodes was 20 times faster than Kafka running on 4, which is super impressive. But Jack Van Lightley, principal technologist at Confluent, come on Jack, ran many performance tests between Kafka and Red Panda and claims that Red Panda at 4 producers performs really well. But if you increase the amount of producers to 50, then it actually performs worse than Kafka. In fact, if you look closely, it looks like Red Panda performs slightly better than Kafka when using 4 producers. Also, according to Van Lightley, Kafka performs better with a higher number of partitions than Red Panda. Jack has done a lot of testing and produced a ton of graphs and results. I highly recommend you check out his article and also the Hacker News thread that goes along discussing it. The link for all of those should be in the description. But it looks like with the right hardware and the right workload, Red Panda can outperform Kafka. But if you tweak the workload or the hardware, then Kafka can outperform Red Panda. So who wins? Well, it really depends on your workload and your hardware and any kind of benchmarks you can run against them. So because of that, I'm actually going to give performance to both Red Panda and Kafka. Well done, guys. Speaking of performance and monitoring, if you want a really slick way to monitor the performance of your Kafka or Red Panda cluster, then you should check out BetterStack. You can connect BetterStack to Prometheus and create really nice dashboards with a drag and drop interface from all your metrics. BetterStack also has features like status pages, incident management, alerting, and much more, with a really generous free tier and an even more generous paid tier when it comes to metrics. So go and check it out. And we're back. Okay, let's move on to the next section, ecosystem. Kafka has been around for 10 years longer than Red Panda, so it's no surprise that it has a wider ecosystem and wider adoption, with core tools like Kafka Connect, Kafka Streams, and MirrorMaker, not to mention it's widely supported by cloud hosting platforms like AWS and GCP. Although Red Panda Connect claims to have more connectors than Kafka Connect, I think there are so many third-party integrations out there for Kafka, it's difficult to count them all. Not to mention all the tutorials, books, and educational material that exists out there for Kafka is much more than Red Panda. So of course, Kafka wins ecosystem. But then again, it's worth mentioning that Red Panda is Kafka compatible. So in theory, everything that works with Kafka should work with Red Panda as well. Anyway, let's move on to the next section, licensing. Kafka is open source under the Apache 2.0 license, which means if you wanted to, you could find its source code online, fork it, and make some contributions, as long as you're comfortable with Java, which I definitely am not. Red Panda, however, is under the business source license, which means it's not open source. But this does have its advantages. It means you can get great support from the Red Panda team, and you can be certain that this project is maintained with new features coming in regularly. This is not to say there aren't companies out there that are adding enterprise features to Kafka, but the ability to customize Kafka to your own company-specific needs and the ability to fix a bug instead of waiting for a release is a huge advantage. So I'm giving licensing to Kafka. And that's a wrap. So who wins, Kafka or Red Panda? Well, that's up to your team, your tech stack, and your specific needs. For me, I want to stay clear of anything JVM-based, so I'm sticking with the furry animal.